certain Ying Hsien, qualified as, and you can imagine, please. Is the first and the only Singaporean master of wine in 2015. He won the Institute of Masters of Wine Champagne Trinity Scholarship 2010. And he was nominated to attend the Master Napa program in September 2013. He also won a French Wine Society scholarship for the Sud de France Master Level program. In 2013, the AXA Millésime Scholarships. Member of l'Ordre des Coteaux de Champagne, la Confrérie des Chevaliers Test Wine, and la Commanderie de Bordeaux, Mr. Yin started testing and stewing wine as a hobby in 1983, while pursuing law studies at university in the United Kingdom. In 2009, after more than 20 years as a corporate and banking lawyer, he embarked on a different career path, building on his enthusiasm for wine and become a wine journalist, speaker, and educator. He now owns Taberna Wine Academy, where he conducts tasting and classes. Taberna Wine Academy has hosted many leading wine producers, including Laurent Ponceau, Benjamin Leroux, Olivier Umbridge, Nicolas Potel, and others, many others. As a speaker, Mr. Tan organized a hosted Business Times Wine Night for senior business executives in 2010 and co-hosted the wine segments of the Wine and Dine TV series broadcast on the channel News Asia. He wrote occasional columns for Wine and Dine magazine and freelance for a number of publications, including Cuisine and Wine and Appetite. Mr. Tan has been a judge at wine competitions, including the International Wine Challenges held in Singapore, and at the Decanter Asia Wine Awards from 2012 to 2014 in Hong Kong. He was also a judge of the 5th Singapore National Sommelier Competition. He was on the testing panels of Wine & Dine Singapore for a number of years and was consulting wine editors of Cuisine & Wine. Mr. Tan was a wine consultant to the World Gourmet Summit. The wine regions that Mr. Tan has visited include the classic wine regions of France, the Russian stars former cellars at Massandra's, as well as wine region in Australia, Germany, Hungary, Italia, Portugal, and others. Thank you very much to be with us. It's a real pleasure. We are very lucky to welcome you. Thank you very much, and please welcome Mr. Tan. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Bavi. It's a real pleasure and privilege to be here this morning to speak to all of you. I was just thinking when Professor Pavi was going through the build your own course thing, how lucky you are. In my time, we were never given the option of building our own courses. And I was just thinking with the words BYOC, BYO in the food and beverage industry means bring your own bottle. You can bring your own champagne or own container for whatever courses you want to build up. And by the end of this talk, you may, Professor Pavi may be regretting this BYO, so it might be lots of wine at your own courses. I've actually called this a path to mastery, and it's a path to mastery. And it's directed to you as students of ESSEC. You know, you've come here to learn a little bit more about business and about other disciplines as well. And whatever you choose to do, you should choose to do it well and master it well. So a little bit of this is a reprise of a personal journey. And I apologize that I'm going to have to bore you a little bit about my personal journey. And I apologize that I'll be using the words I and me a little bit during the course of this talk. But I think it's to demonstrate a few points. Have you got the pointers? Oh, it's over there. Okay. And it was just to demonstrate a few points about what you should be looking at in terms of any particular subject matter that you choose to study and work on as your occupation. And it doesn't have to be one. You can change along the course. Now, Professor Bavi very kindly introduced me as a as the first Singaporean master of wine. Now, how many people in the audience know about the masters of wine? Anybody know about the masters of wine? Yeah, not that surprising. This chart tells you a little bit. This slide tells you a little bit about what a master of wine is. Can you, anyone interpret this? This is going to be interactive. I want some volunteers to answer the question. What do these numbers mean in terms of being a master of wine? Can anyone guess? Or try and deduce what these numbers mean? Mm-hmm. What else?
The second one is the number of master of wine in the world.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, sorry, the third one.
404 is the number of master of wine in Asia and one in Singapore.
Okay, that was a good attempt there by the front. The first number is the establishment of the masters of wine, the second number being the number in the world, the third number being the number in Asia, and the last number being the number in Singapore. I'm not that egotistical. So, but you're absolutely right. 1953 was when the first six masters of wine qualified. Now, the masters of wine qualification, so it's, you know, 63 years old now, 64 years old. The master of wine qualification was sponsored by something called the Vintners Company in the UK. It is one of the sort of royal companies. There were 12, there are 12, and it dates back to the 14th century. So to be a member, was if these were effectively companies which were like professional guilds. Now, and the master wine qualification was actually developed in the 1950s to ensure the highest quality in the wine trade. And when I mean the wine trade, I mean people who sold and bought wine, not journalists, not winemakers, and so on. So that was the meaning of the wine trade, and it was established by the vintners, the worshipful company of vintners in the UK in 1953. 21 candidates from the wine trade sat for the exam, six passed. Okay, so you had a roughly, you know, 30%, 1/3 pass rate. The next number, before I go on to the next number, that's 1953. Can anyone tell me what else happened in 1953? Significant event. Just think, historically. It's fairly significant. Independence of Singapore? End of the Korean War? Okay, in 1953, Mount Everest was scaled by Edmund Hillary and Norgay, Tenzing Norgay. So that was the first time Mount Everest was actually climbed. Actually, both the Masters of Wine, the conquest of Mount Everest happened about the same time. In that same period of time, roughly since then, and as of February 2014, 4,042 people have climbed Mount Everest successfully and survived it. Okay, so there have been a lot of people who died along the way, but that's the number who have successfully climbed Mount Everest since 1953. So it's actually a bigger number now. I don't know what the number, the up-to-date number. That was as of February 2014, was the most recent number I could find. 404 is the total number of people who have ever qualified as a master of wine since 1953. So, in other words, you have 10 times the chance of meeting someone who has climbed Mount Everest than meeting a master of wine. It just puts the thing in scale, because we're talking about people who commit to doing something well, whether it's climbing a mountain or mastering the subject of wine. And there might be different scales of it, and there are probably a lot more people who feel much more energized by being able to hit the peak of Mount Everest. There's another interesting statistic, which is in 1957, was the first man in space. There had been over 550 people in space since 1957, but again, that exceeds the number of Masters and Wives. So you actually have a better chance of meeting an astronaut or someone who's climbed Mount Everest. Now, the one refers to the fact, and this is talking about achievement and a passion and a drive and a motivation to do your best in whatever you do. It also shows a little bit of how people who do these things aren't just focused on that one thing. There is one Master Wine who has also climbed Mount Everest. So that's actually really quite a unique statistic. Okay. So that's just a little bit about the Masters of Wine, its history, and its background to some extent. Now, I didn't start at the wine trade. So how did I become a master of wine? In 1984, about 30 years after the first Masters of Wine, the first non-wine trade master of wine qualified. It's a lady called Janice Robinson, whom some of you may have heard of. She's written a few books. She had an extensive TV series in the UK in the 80s and the 90s. And she broke that monopoly of the wine trade. And since 1984, the Masters of Wine has grown to embrace not just people who sell and buy wines or trade wines, but also people who make wines. You see, interestingly, right up to 1984, winemakers or wine producers were not allowed to become Masters of Wine. So the first wine producer Master Wine, I think, was in 1985, 1986. So it's an interesting point, because as an organization that has to survive, that reflects what was actually quite a small insular wine trade, it's adapted itself, it's moved on with the times, it's become much more international, it's broadened its scope. And that's a lesson for all of us as individuals as well. Always keep your mind open, always move on, always be adaptable. So that was in 1984-85. Now, around that time, I was a university student in the UK. And how did I end up being a master of wine? So let me just sort of move on to the next slide. Okay. Now, this is a little bit about how I became a master of wine. Can anyone work it out? This is going to be a talk about puzzles. I don't want you all just sitting there and waiting for the wine that's going to come at the end of this session.
This is sugar.
The last one's sugar, yeah. That's the last line. Very good. Any other volunteers about? We've got one volunteer in front, that the last line is the chemical equation for fermentation of sugar into alcohol and CO2, carbon dioxide. So that's clearly wine related. What about the other two? Okay, I'll put you out of your misery. This is actually, and it's really difficult to decipher this, but there are three very different things here on the screen. And that's a reflection of my life since my early 20s. When I went to university in the early 1980s, I was a physics major in my first university I attended. That first equation is Einstein's field equation. So from his general theory of relativity. So out of that equation, you get all that stuff about black holes and curvature, space-time, and all that sort of stuff. So when I was a kid, my romance was actually being a great physicist and a scientist. And I started off university, going to study physics in King's College University. But one of the things that actually became very apparent to me and which is kind of depressing for me at that point in time, was that I had absolutely zero talent for physics. I was the first person in King's College Labs to have blown up a battery for a start in 20 years. And my math was just horrendously bad. And it's one of those realizations. If you pick something, even if you love it, if you're no good at it, don't bang your head on it. So that's something to bear in mind. We all have our pride in what we want to do and our romance and stuff like that. We want to carry on doing that. But as young people moving on and starting out in your careers, and you will have very clear, strong ideas of what you may want to do, and when you get out into the world and you start working and you're moving through the corporate world or setting up your own businesses, you're going to run into difficulties. There are going to be times where you're going to have to sort of realize that you don't have that necessary talent. Do what you're good at. That's how you succeed. So I dropped out of physics. And the next line is caveat emptor, which is a legal principle about buyer beware. It's Latin for buyer beware, which is a principle in terms of contract law and sales of goods that you have to be careful of what is being sold to you. So there's a balance between the seller being able to sell you anything they want, but you also being aware of the risk of what you're buying. So buyer beware. So that is just a reflection of the fact that after sort of not doing too well in my first year in physics, I switched to law. Now, you see, this is the funny thing about life. It was about that point in time that I started getting interested in wine. And, you know, you can joke about the fact I became a barrister and I went to the wrong bar, right? You know, instead of going to the wine bar, I went to the legal bar. But, you know, it was a choice I made. But it actually also allowed me the opportunity to pick up the hobby of actually learning and appreciating wine. Now, I'll be perfectly honest with you, I had no intention of taking wine particularly serious. To be absolutely honest, I was a student, you know, I was in my early 20s. I picked up wine because it was and going for wine courses and wine appreciation classes because it was an easy way for me to get my alcoholic fix. It was a cheap way of getting an alcoholic fix rather than going to the bar or a bar and spending loads of money, you know, for, you know, £3 or £4 go for wine tasting, you know, 5 or 6 wines and you get yourself drunk and it was great, you know. So, but then, you know, I sat down and I actually listened to some of the talks and I actually got very interested. And in those days, wine's big business today. It really is a big business. And it's a very popular thing. In those days, there were not very many books. I went to the local bookshop and I picked up the 2 or 3 books they had. If you go to Kinokuniya today, there's a whole bookshelf of books on wine. When I went to buy, it was 2 or 3 books and I bought them. And I started getting really interested in wine. And it's just my nature, I'm a bit of a geek. I got very sort of involved and interested in wine. And but for me, it wasn't going to be a career. And I stuck with the law. And actually, in a sense, that was the right decision. That paid a lot more money than being in the wine trade. It allowed me to indulge in my passion of wine, getting very happy along the way. So that was a little bit of the path, a little bit of the lessons about how you get to that whole process. Now, why do I find this interest in wine? It is a little bit geeky, and it might be a bit boring for all of you. But it isn't just about wine. I'll get to the wine bit later on, because actually it's a little bit about the journey and the things that go on around the whole issue of wine and how wine actually is intimately tied in with the theme of this Imagination Week, which I believe is growing the city-state, politics, policy, and society. Is that the title of this? Yeah. Actually, wine is very integral to that whole topic. So that was a slightly long-winded introduction to why I wanted to talk to you about wine in the context of that. And that next slide starts that whole process. So again, a question to you, what do those numbers mean? And this is all driven by the fact that I'm interested in wine.
Thank you.
Okay, so a volunteer here has said, I've tasted between 7,000 to 8,000 wines. Okay, this is the joy and also the pain of being a wine professional. I taste 7,000 to 8,000 wines a year. Any other volunteers? Okay, this one's quite tough. It's quite interesting. What those numbers mean? 7,000 to 8,000 refers to the number of years ago is the earliest archaeological evidence of wine being made from the modern vine species, Vitis vinifera. This was in an area between the Black Sea and the Caspian Sea, when what is now known as Georgia. That was 7,000 to 8,000 years ago. 2,700 refers to the first written evidence of wine in Greece. Between that time, 7,000 to 8,000 years ago to 2,700 years ago, that whole culture of wine production, wine consumption, moved from that bit of Eurasia, Asia, Georgia is technically in Asia, down through the Fertile Crescent into Greece, and you start seeing the first written evidence, which actually means it was probably in Greece a bit earlier than that, but the first written evidence is around 2,700 years ago. So, the question is, and I don't know, how many of you here actually drink wine, are familiar with some of the wine terminology? Good. Do any of you who put your hands up sort of know the difference between Old World and New World wine? Have you come across those terms, Old World and New World wines? No? Okay. You have?
Yes.
Yeah. So tell me what you think of Old World, New World wines.
Old World is Europe, and New World is Argentina, Brazil, and Australia, California, for example.
Okay. So you said Old World is Europe. New World is California, Argentina, Australia, and places like that. I've got your answer. And that is the conventional way of looking at Old World versus New World. Now, can I ask you, I'll start with you. Do you know when was the first time the term New World was used?
No.
Anybody know? Well done. 1503 was the first reference to the New World. And what was the New World? Americas, correct. Now, when Columbus discovered the Americas, he didn't realize he had discovered the Americas. He thought he had found a shortcut to Asia. So when he went back to Europe, to Portugal and Spain, he was saying that, and he told, you know, the courts and the news spread that he had found the shortcut to Asia. And that was in the 1490s, or whatever it was, whenever it was he got to the Americas. Just before 1503, after him, an Italian adventurer and cartographer, Amerigo Vespucci, also got to the Americas, and he suddenly realized that Columbus had got it wrong. This was not Asia. This was a completely new world. And he wrote to his sponsor and patron, one of the Medicis in Italy, to say that Columbus had got it wrong and that this was the new world. So it rapidly spread that this was the new world, and that terminology then came into place that the new world referred to North and South America, and the old world was really Africa and Eurasian continent. Now, if you go back to what I said, 7,000 to 8,000 years ago, wine was first produced in Georgia, which is actually Asia or Eurasia at best, and you see the first evidence in Europe actually around 2,700 years ago. And the Phoenicians had it at least 3,500 to 4,000 years ago, and that's really part of Asia. Anatolia, which is now Turkey, had wine production about 4,000 to 5,000 years ago. So in many ways, the old world of wine is Asia, it's not Europe. You know, from a historical and political perspective. But the dominance of European viticulture and colonization from the 15th and 16th centuries onwards has led to this convention that the old world is European winemaking. And actually, a lot of the old ancient wine techniques are being rediscovered now. And in Georgia, they have gone back to producing wine in a method that was known at least 3,500, 4,000 years ago, where they ferment the wines in huge clay amphora pots buried in the ground, covered up, fermented. And you would think that's a pretty primitive style of winemaking. I went to Georgia about a year ago, and I actually visited some of these places, including a monastery in the Caucasus, and they actually make stunningly good wines, very good wines in those old styles. Very different from the modern style of wine. But that's, if you want to really think about it, that's old world wine. So I've actually moved away from using the words old world, new world, which is a very received, customary way of looking at wines in the wine world. But I actually, you know, and when I talk to other wine professionals, they actually scratch their head, yeah, actually, you're right. And the fact of the matter is the terminology of old world, new world wines is very recent. It's a late 20th century thing. If you look at the literature that was written about wine, even in the 1950s, there's no reference to new world or old world. In fact, one of my little projects is to figure out, maybe one of you, if you ever get interested in this, is to figure out the history of when old world, new world started being used in the context of wine. It's a convenient shorthand, but it's an inaccurate shorthand. But it just goes to show that an interest in wine goes beyond the purely sensory pleasures of tasting wine, which we'll get to. You know, this is to keep your suspense going. But it can actually generate a lot of thought about issues, historical, for example, from this perspective. Political, what it means to be old world, new world. And interestingly, you mentioned Australia. Australia is neither. Hadn't yet been discovered by the European colonial powers. And I'm very rude to my Australian colleagues. You're neither new world or old world. You're just from a convict colony, which is what the British established it as, was a convict colony. But to be fair to them, and this is a very silly joke, I always say they make wines a great conviction. So it's a sort of a funny thing, bad pun to use on the poor Australians. I hope there are no Australians here. Are there any Australians here? Any Australians here? No Australians? Oh, good, I can be rude about them then. Okay. This is another aspect of wine, once you get into it. What's that? Any guesses? Someone else?
Different kinds of grapes.
Different kinds of grapes. Time, sorry?
Tree.
A time tree. Different type of grapes.
Represents what different blends of wine can do
size. Represents different kinds of blends. It's a little bit of a combination of all the three answers to some extent. And what this represents is this. It's a genealogy, or it's one of the many genealogies of different grape varieties. And it is a time tree in a sense, because it shows the evolution of grape varieties. Now, you know, many of you have probably heard of things like Chardonnay and Cabernet Sauvignon in terms of wine and so on. And I chose this because this actually shows where Cabernet Sauvignon and Chardonnay came from. And interestingly, they are both great-great-great-grandchildren of Pinot Noir, which is the great variety of Burgundy. So, you know, one of the most exciting things happening in the wine world today is the origins of all these grapes and the genetic makeup of these grapes. Because actually, to some extent, in trying to source or trying to understand where these grapes come from, they're also understanding a little bit of the migratory practices of people in France, in Europe generally. Because if you think about the modern boundaries of France and Italy and Spain are relatively recent. You know, all this was part of the Roman Empire at one point in time. And And then it fell apart, and then all the various wars, the Dark Ages, the Middle Ages, and it's not really till the last 300 or 400. I mean, Italy was only formed, when Garibaldi unite Italy, 1880 or 81 or something like that. So the modern boundaries are very, very young. But if you actually follow some of the migration of these grapes and the origins of these grapes, you almost see a parallel. It's a correlation to some extent, and how strong that correlation is not entirely clear. But you've got the great granddaddies of some of the great varieties here. And it's just a reflection. A lot of people do this. So this is one bit of the wine profession, is that it's not just about talking about wine. It's not just about learning how to drink wine and taste wine. It's also a little bit about history, anthropology. It's also a little bit about science and genetics. I mean, if you think about the biochemistry, that equation of transforming sugar into alcohol and CO2 plus heat, there's a bit of thermodynamics involved in that. In everything you look at, there's always a little aspect. And the most interesting wine discussions are not simply just about the wines, but also a little bit about the culture and the history and the background. And this is what I'm hoping to try and get across to you, is there is more to wine appreciation than simply picking up that glass and tasting the wine. Okay, before we get onto that, and we're getting very close to talking about the wines, one of the things I want to make clear is that, okay, this is just to demonstrate the multiple facets you can create for yourself in terms of understanding where wine is and where it stands in the context of society. Because if I go back to that previous slide where wine was first produced 78,000 years ago, it's not that far off from the first civilizations. So the creation of wine, the cultivation of grape varieties, is very closely connected to our history as human beings, as civilized human beings. The first city-states. Now, the first city-states of Mesopotamia, that was a beer-focused civilization and area, and that's climatic. It was too warm for good quality grapes to be produced, which is why it started a bit further north in Asia, in Georgia, and then moved down through Persia into what we now call Asia Minor and the Middle East and North Africa. Okay, so it actually is a reflection of how civilization evolved. Now, city-states, Singapore's a city-state. What were the ancient city-states? Yep. Greek city-states. And 2,700 years ago, first written reference to the Greek Greek wine culture. And Greek wine culture, it's often underestimated. You see a lot of books talking about the romance of wine, the history of wine, and so on. But let's not forget, why was it such an integral part of Greek culture? It wasn't just an integral part of Greek culture. They were agrarian economies. It was fundamentally important for them to be able to grow grapes, partly because of the alcohol, so that it could purify what was frankly often unclean water in urban centers. That was one way of managing health issues. So if you think about the growth of city-states, and you know, I think there's some papers that actually talk about the first ancient city-states often having the state of health of its citizens worse than the people out in the countryside. And that's because when you're in a tight urban center, you're more likely to fall prey to flu and sickness and so on. So, you know, if you think about why wine or beer or any other alcoholic beverage became such an important part of civilization in those days, it was partly a health issue. And because of that, it was also an economic issue, because you had to grow the grapes, you had to make it, and initially it was subsistence. Each owner of a little plot of land would make his own grapes, make his own wine, grow his own livestock, and rear his own livestock, and so on. But as city-states grew, demand starts outstripping supply, and that's when the whole agrarian economy starts moving along. Okay, quite apart from Greece, which was full of city-states, Athens, Sparta, and all those places, what's the other significant ancient city-state? The
16th century.
Okay, I'm thinking much older than that. The other significant one is Rome. No one really thinks of Rome as a city-state, but it was a city-state. Okay. It's the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire wasn't a country, it was an empire. But Rome itself was a city-state. And there are some theories about why the Roman Empire actually collapsed. One of it to do with the stress on its economy. And its economy was very much largely an agrarian economy. Most of those ancient economies were agrarian. And people forget just how much that had to play in terms of politics. One of the reasons they actually had to keep conquering new lands was to pay off its legionaries and to create new supply of grain, of land to reward its legionaries. And in doing so, they actually had to actually plant vines along the way to support the Roman conquest. Now, if you read Julius Caesar's books, and he did write on the war in Gaul, before each battle, he would actually give every one of his legionnaires a liter of wine and some bread. And that's all they had to survive a whole day of fighting. Because it was energy, it was calories. But also generally, there are lots of statistics. And it's interesting, if you read some of the old stuff, whether it's Pliny or Columella and so on, a lot of their writing, particularly the Roman writers, wasn't focused on the romance of wine, drinking and stuff. There was some of that. But there was a lot of economic information in there about how much the wines cost, the wine trade, how important it was to supplying the urban centers. So even in the context of something like today's topic, wine has a huge relevance. Most of us don't think of wine in those terms, but actually when you think about it, it was actually fundamental to the growth of the Roman Empire, was fundamental to some extent to Greek philosophy. Does anyone know where the word symposium comes from? This is sort of a symposium in some ways, but does anyone know where the origin of the word symposium? It's a Greek word, it's derived from the Greek, and it derives from the Greek practice of actually having a discussion or debate after dinner, but with lots and lots of wine. It was a wine-focused discussion after dinner. And Plato writes about it, all the philosophers write about it, and there are many descriptions of the Greek symposia. So the word symposium is intimately sort of linked into this whole idea of wine consumption and the wine culture. Convivium is the Latin word for a similar thing that the Romans actually did. The difference being that they did their discussions over dinner, not just with wine on its own. So maybe the Greeks are a little bit more alcoholic than Romans. And maybe that's why the Romans managed to build an empire around the Greeks, but there you are. So you can actually speculate about all that. But I think what I want to give you a flavor of is two things. One is, first of all, you know, in any topic you choose to study and make your life, get to know it well, and get to understand all the different facets that come into it, because it actually gives you a broader understanding. This is what education is all about. It's not just about being focused on one line of inquiry or one particular profession or one particular subject or specialism. It is also to give you a broader view of how everything sort of fits together in terms of history. And wine actually, you know, it's a very rich and ripe topic in terms of your imagination week, city state, politics, policy, and society. Because, I mean, you know, how the agrarian economy, how wine was needed to sort of slake the thirst of the Roman legionnaires building the empire, all were political, policy, and societal issues, both in ancient Greece and ancient Rome. And, you know, in many ways, that has continued to the modern day, perhaps right up to the Industrial Revolution. The whole economy of Europe was very much agrarian until the Industrial Revolution, and even post-industrial, there are still very strong economic issues involved. Wine's large, France's largest export till British, not till Airbus overtook it, was wine. Wine was the most important contributor to the French economy before Airbus actually became the biggest income generator for the country. So it's still very important from many, many, many perspectives. Okay, so that's just to give you a sense of how wide-ranging a simple interest in wine can be. Now, that's just to try and relate it into what you're talking about. In terms of becoming someone who's interested in wine, there's obviously the romance, and I'll get to the romance. It's one of those, I alluded to this, it's just fun drinking a lot of wine, getting very happy, getting a little bit drunk over dinner, whatever it is. But there's also a wonderful bit to the enjoyment of wine, and that's the whole sensory enjoyment of wine. Wine's a very sensual sort of thing, when you want to fully enjoy it. It's not just a question of, if you just want to simply get drunk, just pick up the glass, drink it, and have lots of wine, and that's fine, you know, if you just want to do that. But if you want to actually sort of expand your senses around that liquid in the glass, there's a lot you can do. And I can tell you that when I first started getting interested in wine and seriously tasting it, my whole awareness of my world around me, just in terms of what I was seeing visually, noticing, and smelling and tasting, became much more acute. It's a trained thing. So I might be a master of wine, but masters of wine are not particularly special in terms of their ability to taste. We're not super tasters. It's all trained. It's entirely up to you as an individual to make that commitment to learn about all that stuff that's in that little glass of wine. And that stuff can lead you to learning about history, politics, economics, whatever you want. But it all starts. And that's what's so nice about doing wine, because you can enjoy it while you're doing it. Now, so I will need some volunteers. We're going to do a little bit of what's called a blind wine tasting. And I will need 8 volunteers. Okay, 1, 2, stand up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. First come, first serve. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. Just come out to the front. Two, four, six. We got 9 people. 2, 4, 6, 7, 8. Okay, who wants to volunteer to drop out? Okay, sorry about that. So we got 3 girls, 5 boys. Okay, do you want to form yourself into teams of 2? Okay, so just if you're happy with who you're standing next to, that's great. Now, if we can arrange to get some glasses of wine provided, what is going to happen is you're each going to be given 2 glasses of wine. They'll be marked, so they'll be each different one. You won't know what's in the wine, in the glasses. I will tell you eventually the 2 different styles of wines, but you have to figure out which one is which based on what I'm going to say about tasting wine, okay? And to keep you company, I will be, this is known as blind tasting, when you don't know what's in the glass and you have to identify what it is. I will be tasting blind with you as well, okay? So, but I will give everyone here, before you start tasting, and we'll just leave the glasses on the table first, before you start tasting, I will give everyone a little quick lesson on the technique of wine tasting. And this is the bit I'm sure you've all been waiting for, is how to taste wine, rather than going on about the history and politics and stuff. But let me just, okay, it's all been marked up. So how's the marking going?
Yeah, two groups. So the missing one get two glasses, right?
Yeah, but the two different wines,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, two different wines.
But so, you know which one is which?
Yes, I
know. Okay. Okay, so this is one set with all the plastic and nets. Okay, good. Okay, so this is going to be a quick run through, and I wasn't going to make the whole talk about learning how to taste wine because it's a lifetime. I'm still learning how to taste wine in many ways. It's one of the joys about wine. It evolves just like history, humanity, human beings, and it's a lifelong passion and stuff. But what I want to give you is the basic techniques of what you should be looking for when you want to fully appreciate what's in that glass in front of you. And it also will help you when I describe the two different styles of wine when you actually get to tasting those, okay? So, next slide. Now, there are three things you need to just keep in mind when you're tasting wine. Okay, it's all about sensory perception. That's why I've got a couple of paintings up there. Just out of curiosity, can anyone recognize the artist? Very good. It is Caravaggio, one of the sick backers and one of the healthy effeminate backers. Okay. So the first thing, the point I'm making about this is appearance. Yeah, I mean, it's related to the theme because it's backers, and backers is the god of wine. It's the appearance. You've got one fatty, rosy-looking character in good health, and you've got one rather sick-looking backers looking kind of forlorn. So actually, that's the first thing you do when you look at a glass of wine, is you look at its appearance. And it's not just the color. It is the appearance of the wine, how bright it is, how sort of enticing it looks. Even if it looks bright and clear, it's got a lovely color, then it just looks like it's something that's gonna, that you want to sort of drink. If it looks kind of murky and dusty or whatever it is, or it's got a fly in it, you don't really want to have that glass of wine. Okay, so the first thing to do is to look at the appearance. Now that's often a quality and condition driver in terms of why you look at that. It's first of all, clarity, brightness of wine tells you a little bit about the condition of the wine. Make sure it's not a sick wine versus a wine that's in good condition, which is on the second side. But the other thing that color and appearance can tell you, but this takes years and years in practice, I'm not expecting you, but it's just to let you know, is that you can actually tell a little bit about the grape varieties and possibly even the region, just looking at the color. I once did this many, before I was a wine professional, I once did this about 20 years ago. Someone brought out a couple of glasses of wine and I said, oh, that one's a Pinot Noir. And I was actually right. And without even getting close to the glass of wine, it was just the color. Pinot Noir is a much lighter colored wine than say Cabernet Sauvignon or Bordeaux. So Burgundy is usually a much lighter colored wine than Bordeaux is. It was a complete fluke. I was joking, but it actually turned out I was right. But it also brought home to me when I was joking about that how important it is to look at appearance and color. So you can learn a little bit from color. Now, I wouldn't want to spend too much time on that, but it's just to make the point that there are three steps, and this is the first step. Look at the wine. You're using all your senses. God gave you, the universe gave you your eyes, your ears, your mouth, your nose. Use them to the fullest when you're actually tasting a wine. Okay, so that's the second bit. I'm using very art metaphors here. So, it's a rather ugly old man with an ugly nose, and that's a Leonardo da Vinci painting of a nose. It's just a humorous attempt to say that the next stage you need to be looking at is the nose, smelling the wine. This is often the most important part of a wine tasting. Is smelling the wine, because you get so much information on the wine itself. Because similar to looking at the appearance, you can actually tell whether a wine is in good condition or is off, or is corked, or is oxidized. So smelling the wine is extremely important in terms of telling you the characteristics of what you're going to be looking at and identifying and judging the quality of the wine in the context of what you're smelling and that grape variety or the region where it comes from. So before you start tasting, I'm going to actually demonstrate how all that's supposed to work. So nosing is the next bit. And this is very important because everything you smell in terms of flowers, leather, smelly drains, cat's pee, whatever it is in your nasal passages. It's literally up your nose, nothing in your mouth. All your mouth does is taste sweetness, saltiness, sourness, bitterness, and umami. And that's generally all you get in your mouth. And when you actually put a wine in your mouth and you are getting some of those flavors, it's because some of those vapors are actually going up your nostrils, your back nasal passages. So this is why, and I'm going to take two glasses first. This is why when wine tasters, wine enthusiasts, whether they're professional or amateur, but wine enthusiasts who are serious about tasting their wine, will not only look at their wine, they spend a lot of time sticking big, fat, ugly nose into the glass and having a good whiff. So this is the first thing you need to note is, don't worry about the appearance because they all look pretty good, is swirl the wine. Okay, swirl the wine if you can without spilling it on yourself because that releases all the molecules that will go into your nasal passages that will tell you about that wine. Okay, great, thanks. And when you smell the wine, don't be afraid. Don't you know, put your nose right in. Just stick it right in. Have a good whiff, okay? You just and draw in as much as you can and try and identify what those smells are. Now, this is often the hard bit, and this is why wine professionals spend a lot of time tasting wine, and it's all about vocabulary and wine vocabulary. It's trying to decide which smell you're getting. Smells of apple, which smells of mango, which smells of cat pee, and putting a name to it. So putting a name to it is actually where the hard work comes. And once you've done that hard work, it goes into your memory. Now this is, the sense of smell is one of the oldest bits of your human physiology in terms of survival. So whether or not you are consciously remembering that smell, your brain's doing it for you. All you have to do is put a name to it and work in your retrieval system so you can pull out what you're smelling and give a name to it. Because that, and that's actually all wine professionals are good at, is actually their retrieval system and training their nose to identify a smell and give a name to it. Because that's how you do the blind tastings and how you assess quality of your wine. Okay? Then this is the final bit. You put it in that big open mouth. This is the scream, and hopefully you don't scream in pain from the wine. So that's munches the scream, and munch. It's like munch in the mouth, but whatever it is. So that's the most important bit. It's actually not the most important, but it's the one of the most important. It's the final bit of an important process of looking at the wine, smelling the wine. It's putting it in the mouth. Now, what happens when you put it in the mouth? There are two things. One is, you want to confirm the smells that you had. And there's a particular technique that most wine professionals go through and a lot of wine enthusiasts learn as well. And it's that very rude thing. If you've been to a wine dinner with a wine professional, they will take in the wine and go, and they will do all sorts of very rude noises. And actually, they end up looking a little bit like that. And then they'll spit the wine out or swallow it. But there's a reason for doing that. It's actually to force all those molecules with the warmth of your mouth and slurping it in with some air to go up your nasal passages. Literally, wine is up your nose, basically. You know, it actually, everything you want to enjoy about flavor of wine is up in your nose. But that's not the end of it. There are two bits to what goes on in the mouth. Because once it's in the mouth, there's texture, this feel. There's a sense of weight to what the wine feels. It can feel light, watery, medium-bodied, heavy-bodied, full-bodied, sweet, or dry. Now, this is probably the only technical thing I'm going to tell you today in terms of wine tasting. The difference between a dry wine and a sweet wine. It's something that's very confused. Dry is just the opposite of sweet. That's it. And sweet in wine tasting means not just the sensation of sweetness, but the sensation of tasting residual sugar. That means natural sugar that's left over after the fermentation of grape sugar into alcohol. Alcohol itself, ethanol, actually tastes sweet. And there are certain things that give a sensation of sweetness without actually being sweet, which is why you can have artificial sweeteners as well, but no sugar. When wine professionals talk about sweet wines, they are talking about wines that actually have sugar, residual sugar, not added sugar, sugar that's left over after the fermentation process. So it's very important that when you describe a wine as sweet, you are being very precise in saying, yes, there is residual sugar in this wine, not a sensation of sweetness of very ripe fruit, for example, or a high level of alcohol. And dry is simply the opposite of that. Okay, so of the two wines we've got here, neither of them should have particularly much residual sugar, so they are both technically dry wines. But you will have a temptation to describe them as sweet because they're actually both quite ripe in character. Okay, so don't use the word sweet in that context, because if you do, most wine professionals, sweet, it's got no sugar left in it. So when you actually taste these wines, what you want to do is take it in, roll it around, almost chew the wine. It's not quite, you know, but you want to sort of move the wine around in your mouth, feel the wine, feel how heavy it is. Look out for sourness, which is acidity. Look out for any bitterness, sweetness. There should not be any residual sugar. And saltiness, you don't generally get in these styles of wine, okay? For you, the most important thing is probably the aromatics, because I chose these wines for very different aromatics to help you decide which is which. Okay, so before I tell you what the wines are, let me just sort of demonstrate very quickly. Okay, so appearance, you all know. Have a good sniff. And I'm not going to swallow this guy. I'm not driving, but I need to work this afternoon. I'm going to spit it out, so I'll show you how to spit too. See, you learn all sorts of things. You learn the art of elegant spitting. Okay, and spit. Now, it may look easy spitting. It's not that easy. It's not that difficult, but it's not that easy either. The idea about spitting is to do it in one stream, not go bloop, you know, just like the picture there. Okay? So, that's the tasting process. Look at the wine, smell it, taste it. You guys can swallow. You're just going to be building your own course later. And whereas I've got to go and do some real work. And then try and identify the two wines. Now, what I've given here are two white wines. They are both made from a single grape variety, so it's actually pretty easy. One is made from Chardonnay, and I'm sure those of you who drink have heard of Chardonnay. Chardonnay is a grape variety that originated in France. It's most famous from a wine region called Burgundy, and I think the one we have here is a Burgundian Chardonnay. And Chardonnay tends to be a very neutral grape variety. And by neutral, it means it doesn't have those very pungent smells of, say, kiwi fruit or mango or durian or anything of that. So, it's got a more subtle sort of flavor of apple, pear, melon. It's a fairly neutral variety. And sometimes it's so neutral you can't even pick up any fruit character. Okay, so wines don't always have to have fruit. People, if you read wine reviews and stuff, people might, if some of you have, you'll see these descriptions of strongly cherry, raspberry, whatever it is. Now, not all wines will necessarily have a fruit character. So, but this is what I mean, is you need to sort of think about building up your own wine palate. Now, but for the purposes of this tasting, just focus on the fact that the Chardonnay, that one will be a Chardonnay. The Chardonnay will be quite neutral. It'll be more apple-y. There'll be a sort of maybe a savory, almost salty, actually what they call a mineral aspect. You can't quite place it. It might be a little bit nutty, a little bit biscuit, but it's not that very strong fruit character. Now, the other grape variety, which we're going to be tasting, is Sauvignon Blanc. And Sauvignon Blanc is also a French variety, and I think it showed up in my previous slide with the genealogy of the grapes. Sauvignon Blanc is very different from Chardonnay. It's very pungent. It tends to have from non-European countries, it tends to have this very pungent sort of tropical fruit smell, it can be mango sometimes, it can be papaya. Papaya was one that came up recently. So it's got this very strong fruity smell, usually, but it also has a very green smell. And when I say green, it's almost like a green bell pepper. It's almost grassy, herbal. So there's a sort of green character to the nose. Okay, the main thing is its pungency. It's what's called an aromatic variety versus Chardonnay, which is considered a neutral variety. So, now I've divided you into teams of two so that you can talk amongst yourselves. And all you have to do is each person picks up two glasses, and you just have to identify which is the Chardonnay and which is the Sauvignon Blanc based on what I described to you. And for the teams that actually identified correctly, you're welcome to come and join me at Taberna Wine Academy for a little tasting, and I'll teach you a little bit more about wine tasting, okay? So, everyone, if you wanna just take two glasses, one in front and one in the back, that's right. And then go back into your teams and then smell and taste the wines and decide. Which is which? Taste it, solid.
Because you can save.
Hmm?
You can save already.
You can save. Ooh, that's very good. But you can taste it if you want. That's not bad. We should stop some of this. It's not bad. Doing for time? And for the rest of you in the audience, you're all going to get to taste this wine after the presentation upstairs. So don't feel left out.
And if any of you are interested in learning more about wine, you can always leave your details with us or Professor Pavi, and we'll put you on our mailing list. Okay, you guys need any more time? You guys are ready, you guys are ready. Okay, we have to have a time limit to this, so make your decisions now, when you're ready. Okay, so we'll go team by team. So the dotted wine, what did you think that was?
The Sauvignon Blanc.
You thought that was the Sauvignon Blanc. Dotted wine, what did you think that was? You thought it was a Chardonnay as a team. So there's a team decision. So Sauvignon Blanc, Chardonnay. 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 Okay. Why did you think it was Chardonnay?
Well, it was more dry, and definitely for me, the fruited smell and taste was
okay.
Taste is more neutral.
Okay, that's correct. I think it is. I actually don't know what the answer is, but I think those are the Chardonnays. That is the Chardonnay, Emily? Yeah. Okay, so sometimes, you know, I get it wrong, so. So congratulations. Chardonnay, and the other one was Sauvignon Blanc. And as you correctly pointed out, it's much more neutral. It doesn't have so much of that very exuberant fruit. The other one with the plastic color had that much more pungent, almost grassy. It was almost herbal in terms of its nose, and that was the big differentiator. It was much stronger in terms of what came out in the nose. So so you're the lucky six. You're going to come for tasting. So my general manager Kiyun is here in front. If you could give your contact your email address to her and or a phone number. We'll be in touch and set up a time with all six of you come to Taberna for a tasting. And we'll find a consolation prize for you guys. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can I close again? Mr. Tan, thank you.